Hi, everybody. I'll be right with you. Can somebody say they heard me?
Can hear you.
We can hear you.
Yes, we can hear
Heard you.
you.
Heard you.
Great, thank you. Well, that's not good. So, hello everyone. Let's see how many people are here. Get my Zoom up top and so it's 20. No. 20. It's 27. Okay, that's good enough. Great. Okay, so I'm going to start by calling roll. Well, let me start by introducing myself, actually. Hi, I'm Terry Towery. You can call me Terry if you want to. You can call me Professor Towery if you want to. Both my parents and my wife are also Professors Towery, so I sometimes like look backwards if you say that. The art departments generally are somewhat informal. Art history, not so much. I'm an artist first, a historian in my own discipline second. I've been making pictures for over 40 years. I've been teaching the history of photography here and at the New School Parsons for 20 of those years. This is a subject that I'm very passionate about. I have a really strong love for this particular discipline. I'm a collector as well as a maker, so usually when I teach the class, I bring in my own examples from my personal collection so that you can hold them in your hand and see them in person, IRL, and experience what an actual collector photograph looks like. And it's very different than a snapshot that you might be used to. Depending upon your age, I see that we have a wide variety of ages in here. Some of you may not have experienced printed photographs very often in your lives. Most of you, if you're in your 20s or younger, would probably have lived mostly online with your photography experiences, with Instagram and other social media platforms that you might choose to use. This is the history of photography, so most of the things we'll be talking about are objects, are prints, are real things. I'm really excited about this. I really hope that this will be a good experience. I think that there is a certain difficulty and disadvantage of doing this all online, although there's also the convenience factor, which makes it maybe balances that out. But I think that I miss the real classroom. I've spent my 30-year teaching career in a real classroom with people's eyes looking at me, and I can tell if they're understanding things by their facial expressions or if they're looking down at their crotch and they're texting someone else. So it's really sort of a disadvantage, I think, for all of us that we don't get to build the community that is often formed in real classes, but here we are. By the way, I'm also chair of the department in these times, so I'm trying to manage the whole department's special needs while also teaching. The First thing I want to do here is call roll. So we'll start with the graduate students. Is Mitchell here? Please shout out.
Mitchell? Oh, I'm here. Yes. Shamika? Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, okay. Leora Engelhard? Leora? Yeah. Okay. And Gracie Margie?
Here.
Okay. So I'm going to move over to the undergraduate roster. let's see where I put that. And it should be there. All right, so looks like Miss Barreto.
Here.
Go by Ashley or Nicole?
Ashley.
Okay. Emily Beregovich?
Here. Beregovich.
Beregovich, okay. Asia Brown? Asia?
Here.
Okay. Briani?
Here.
Brandon Correa?
Right here.
Angelica Cruz?
Here.
Jessica Fernandez de Jesus?
Here.
Justin Gadsden?
Here.
Francina Gores?
Here.
Cole James Graham?
Right here.
Michelle Granda.
Here.
Yurixa Jimenez.
Here.
Edith Maria.
Here.
David Myron.
Here.
Anna. Anna Nosworthy. Devana Peralta.
Here.
Lena Peralta.
Here.
Andrea Resendez Gomez. Andrea. Daniela Reyes.
Here.
Gregory Reyes. Gregory Reyes.
Can you hear me?
Okay, there, yep. Andrew Rivera.
Here.
Jessica Romero.
Here.
Omari Saxby.
Present, here.
Carol Young.
Here.
Okay, great. So that's pretty good attendance. And so the first thing we have to do is deal with the details of the class. So I'm going to share my screen with you all so that you can see what I'm looking at and we can talk about it together. So you all see the syllabus, right?
Yes.
Hi, Professor, you didn't call my name. Okay. I'm just wondering.
Which, wait, let me get back to the rosters. Are you an undergraduate or graduate student?
Graduate.
This one though, let's see. What's your name?
Vanessa Jones.
All right, let me.
You might have me down as Vanessa Isabella.
Let me see if I'm looking at the right screen, just to make sure. Yes, there it is. I was looking at a different screen, I'm sorry.
Okay, thanks.
All right, thanks for pointing it out. And let's go back to here. Okay. So now I need to bring that forward. All right. So history of photography, her story of photography, right? Most histories have been written by men. And I do just want to sort of talk to that just for a moment. And I've been racking my brain about this a lot. Especially the first century of the history of photography is primarily dominated by white European men. And there are very few exceptions to that. So I'm going to try to make the class as diverse and include as many international photographers from around the world as possible, including women as well. And so the unfortunate truth is that it's more likely that people of diverse backgrounds were the subjects of the photographs rather than the people behind the camera. And so I will reiterate this as the course goes along during the semester, but I think you'll notice the diversity is by omission, actually, and that's really a sad thing. So I'm aware of it, and I will try to do my best, especially after we get out of the 19th century and into the 20th and 21st century, to introduce photographers of color and from all over the world, and more women. But as I said, really the beginnings of photography were really dominated by white European men. So, and I'm aware of that. So, and that might be something worth some of you doing some of your projects about. And so, when you're thinking about what kind of topics you want to do some of your research projects about, that could be one of them. So the course description is pretty much straight from the Lehman College catalog. It is a kind of survey of the entire history of photography from its invention, or actually from its pre-invention to now. And hopefully I'll be able to get through all of that time period in the time we're given in class. Really what I hope you kind of come away with is a kind of general understanding of some of the major movements and kinds of photography. I'm less interested in you memorizing exact dates as, let's say, within a 20-year window. So I won't be, there's a handful of dates like the first photograph and things like that that I will emphasize in my lecture that you should probably, be aware of exactly when photography was invented, for example. But in general, this is not the kind of art history class where you have to sort of memorize a bunch of dates. There's certain iconic photographers that I will hope you become familiar with and will remember their names. And so again, I will be sure during the lectures to point them out. Generally, they'll be a kind of perfect example of a kind of photography. So we think about street photography. Henri Cartier-Bresson is a sort of iconic street photographer. So, and I'll emphasize all these things. There's really, as I said at the beginning, I normally teach this class in a classroom during a time period where I can assign students to attend an exhibition and they can go see that exhibition. And then if they're art students, make something about the show. If they're not, briefly write something about the show. And then we have a brief discussion about that. I will still ask you to see some exhibitions, but obviously during COVID, it's a difficult time to do that. And so I've been thinking about this really a lot, is the grading calculation and how that might evolve and change. Certainly the reading and participation in class discussions is a big part of your grade, is 10%. The think piece, which is described next door to the final grade calculation, is another 10% where you to find an original photograph, an anonymous found photograph, not something from your own family, but something that you might find in a junk store or even on the street, and to write about that. And we'll talk about that more as it comes along. There will be two, a midterm and a final, somehow, again, I don't know how to give a test online when you can just Google everything. So those, I will figure that out. There will be a final sort of research project, the written thing, and then an oral presentation where each one of you will choose a subject related to the history of photography. That could be an individual photographer or a concept about photography, to do about a 10-minute talk on it with about 15 to 20 slides to illustrate it. So that's kind of what to expect in the class, although I want to be clear that this might change because of the difficulty of administering the kinds of assessment devices that I'm used to using. So there's no textbook in this class. I have listed some suggested textbooks and suggested readings. These are not required, although I've been thinking maybe the graduate students should get the social history, the Robert Hirsch Seizing the Light, a Social History of Photography. I'm going to still leave it as recommended, but that's highly encouraged for the graduate students to at least have a look at some point. Because there's no textbook, attendance is crucial. All of the information for this class will come through my lectures. So you need to be here on time with your sound on and hopefully your cameras on. And actively participating in the class. If you miss more than three, I can fail you. And if because the class is so reliant on the information relayed to you in class, it's crucial that you come. Crucial that you come on time. So the standard sort of don't cheat, don't steal, don't lie kinds of things about academia. We have all kinds of great tools now to see if you actually wrote your own paper. That's really helpful to deal with that stuff. So the final project, which I may sort of increase its weight, is a topic of your own choice to do research on. You don't necessarily have to do a traditional like written term paper per se. It can be a little bit more of a sort of multimedia project with like maybe a slideshow or an interactive thing or even a video. So there's some flexibility on how you create that final says written paper multimedia project. Again, as we go along, I will sort of talk about these things. But certainly by the sixth week of class, you should have figured out a topic that you're interested in doing your final project on and let me know, okay? So any questions about the structure of the class? No? All right, great. So I'm gonna go ahead and get started with the first lecture. Now, in the syllabus here, I have linked the lectures to the weekly topics. For example, if you click on introduction, it opens a PDF document that has all of the slides that I'll be talking about on it. It doesn't have the comments that I'll make about the slides on it. And these are obviously not from this exact class because I haven't given you lectures yet. So these are PDF slideshows from a previous version of the class that I will keep updating as the course goes along with the actual slideshows that I'm presenting. Now, I'm not going to be presenting them from the PDF document, and they are big. I mean big, like 200 to 300 megabytes each, because they're all pictures, and there's lots of pictures, because I like pictures. And so just be aware of that. But the point is that, you know, when you're taking notes, when you're reviewing things for whatever research projects you might want to do, those slideshows will be on the syllabus that you can review that way. And I will, as I said, try to keep them up to date from this iteration of the course. So each week there will be sort of readings that aren't necessarily readings like you might get in a traditional chalk and talk class, but instead are websites that I want you to have a look at. This one is the only actual reading in here, is the Baudelaire on Photography, and you'll see that it's only like, you know, 4 paragraphs long. I mean, they're long paragraphs, but it's not like a 20-page paper that you have to read. So, the sort of, we're gonna talk about history of, you know, and then like, this is a great movie, just watch
this. Writing's not that easy, but Grammarly can help. This sentence is...
Yeah. You just watch that video. It's about 5 minutes long about some guy who actually, you know, we'll talk about these things in the lecture, but I think this DAGS at the Met might not work anymore. No, it does, good, okay. So like that's a 4.5 minute video. So the readings and links are not always like traditional readings. You'll just kind of watch some videos and things. Look at a website that talks about, you know, Southworth and Hawes, who are some of the greatest,
if you thought only as
portrait photographers ever. So that sort of thing. Now, the visual response exercises that I mentioned are up here in the syllabus. And you can see that normally I would ask people to go and see an actual exhibition in a museum or a gallery and either write or make something in response to it, and then we'll have that conversation. So the first visual response exercise that I'm asking you to see let me find it and then I'll share it. Okay, so back to Zoom and I will unshare that screen and share this screen. So this is an exhibition that's at the Whitney Museum in the West Village. It's a collective of African-American photographers from the late mid-century here in New York that sort of formed a group to support each other to make make it work. And so I'd like you all to make an appointment at the Whitney to go. This unfortunately does have an entrance fee. So, as much as I strongly encourage you to actually go to see the show, I know that many of you are unwilling to travel in New York at the moment or do anything outside of your homes, which I completely understand. So in this case, this is an exception for me, is that in lieu of going to see the show, which I encourage you to do, you can do your research directly from this website and sort of look at the imagery, see the videos that are related to the photographers, the individual photographers. And next week, we're gonna have a sort of brief discussion about this group. I honestly don't know how to pronounce this word, so I don't wanna get it wrong. But it's worth sort of either going or spending, you know, half an hour or so browsing the multimedia information for each one of these individual photographers. So that's your first real assignment, if you will, okay? So does everybody understand that? You either you either write a page and a half or so about what you saw, or make photographs, drawings, paintings, installations, performances, slideshows, whatever, in response to the exhibition. So you have a sort of wide variety of methods to respond to the show. Obviously, this exhibition doesn't actually reflect the subject or the topic that we're talking about currently, which is the origins of photography. So, you know, it's not particularly related to our subject matter at the moment.
Hi, Professor, I have a question.
Sure.
When you say that we can make something that that shows what we saw, can we like recreate a photo, or?
If that's what you want to do, sure.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anna Nosworthy, are you here yet?
Okay. Oh yeah, another question. As far as like writing a page and a page and a half on what we see on that site, are we just like, can I just pick something? Am I remarking on basically anything, you know, that I see on that page, or am I like pinpointing a specific topic? Like how am I getting this page and a half?
So what I don't want to be mm-hmm. clear is a description of the photographers and their biographies or anything like that. I'm interested much more in your response to the work you see. So if you went to an art gallery or looked at an art on a line, you would have hopefully intellectual and emotional responses to the artwork, right? That's why we do art. And so I wanna hear that part, not a description. This first photograph had a man standing in the center of a room doing—
Okay, got you.
Thing. I don't care.
Make it more personal, make it more of a reflection of, oh, this is how I felt, this is what I saw.
Yeah, exactly. So next week when we discuss the exhibition, I'll say, so what did you guys think about the show?
Nice.
And you'll be able to give your, you know, your responses. And within reason, those are your own personal responses. And I mean, I don't want to say there's no right and wrong, but there's certainly really wrong, but interpretation has a lot to do with our own individual backgrounds and our own individual lives. And so I may see something in a photograph that you don't, or you may see something that I don't. So does that answer your question?
Oh, yes, it does. Yes, it does. I thought I was muted, but it answers my question.
That's Dana, good. I see your hands up.
Oh, hi. Yeah, this is Cole. I just wanted to say that I just dropped in the chat last week at the Whitney, there was a lecture about this. And it was a really interesting lecture about the exhibition. So the link is there. It was recorded.
Right. Thank you. I don't have my chat window
open. You're welcome.
I don't have enough real estate to have all these things going at the moment. So if you do put something up in the chat, just kind of like say something about it. There's something in the chat, you know, that. But Lena Peralta, do you have your hand up?
Yes. And on the paper, we're supposed to talk about the techniques and the lightings and all that stuff that they use.
If that's something that strikes you the most, then that's fine. But as I said to Omari, I'm more interested in your response to the pictures than descriptions or anything like that. But if what you see and what strikes you the most is, wow, this is amazing light, and the photographer used, you know, shadow, and you know, it's clear to me they used a very grainy kind of film, which gives it a kind of gritty texture, then yeah, that's fine as well. So does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Great, okay. So I'm gonna get started with the lecture. We've already gone almost an hour. So I'm gonna stop sharing this and I'm going to share the lecture screen, which is here, okay. So now I tend to pace and I tend to use my hands when I'm talking a lot. And so my face might disappear from the little window because you should actually be looking at pictures anyways, at least for a while. So just be aware of that. And so, you know, the we talked about this sort of syllabus and the course structure. Here's the link to the online syllabus, which is also in Blackboard. Speaking of Blackboard, I hate it. I think it's the most terribly designed piece of software other than CUNY First that I have ever worked with. So I barely use it, which is why I hand-coded my syllabus on another site. However, that will be the place that I'll ask you to submit your assignments. And so, although I might do something with Dropbox or some other device sharing thing like that, but I haven't quite figured that out yet. But anyways, the link to the syllabus is in Blackboard as well. So, all right. So there's the Zoom meetings. Somebody had trouble not being able to get in because of a password. It's not password protected, so hopefully that was resolved. It's the same link every week. And so just sort of put it down somewhere and just use the same one. So in this slideshow, I've put some websites that people use to do research about photography. These are some of the better known sort of collections that are available online. And the New York Public Library has a great selection of prints and photographs. GEH stands for the George Eastman House, which is up in Rochester, New York. Does anybody know who George Eastman was? Anybody?
I think he was the founder of the Eastman.
Right.
The Eastman photography rolls that we used many years ago.
Right. He was the founder of Kodak. And so he invented the first point and shoot camera, basically, the first idiot proof camera. And we'll talk about him more as things go along. The Library of Congress has a fantastic collection of prints and photographs. The Getty out west also has an amazing collection of photographs that are browsable. American Suburb X is a much more contemporary website that it's designed for adults, but it's not like adult content in that kind of porny way. It is that shows photographs that are, there's sometimes nudity, there's sometimes violence in them. Sometimes they're photographs of war, sometimes they're beautiful nudes, but it has, I think, one of the best collections of contemporary working photographers as well as historical photographers on it. So when you're doing, let's say, your oral presentation or one of your research projects, this is a great place to find articles and images related to your subject. And finally, ubu.com is a collection of sort of Dada materials of all kinds, from audio to video to writings to collage. You know, Ubu was made really right at the beginning of the internet. And I'm sure it wouldn't be possible to be made today because of all the copyright infringement that's going on it, but it's a fantastic site to find, like to listen to Marcel Duchamp talking about beauty. It's like, oh, that's his voice, oh my God, you know, and things like that. So, so these are some of the topics and subjects we'll kind of go over in the next few you know, hopefully somewhat today, not entirely today, but, and so that's kind of a summary. Now, this is a short video about what happened before photography, right? And so this is one of my favorite sort of areas of the class and the lecture is this, it's this kind of invention that happened towards the like first third of the 1800s, where a lot of things were coming together to sort of that ultimately became photography. But this lecture, it's about, I think, 6 minutes long, is from a fellow who just retired from the Eastman House in Rochester, as I mentioned. And he's talking about pre-photography. What did we do before we had photographs? And how is that related to photography? So I'm going to stop the share. I'm going to share that.
Quick question before we move on for assignments. Are we able to, like, are we at any time able to submit them to your email, or are we just going through, you know, Blackboard database, Dropbox, like you said?
You know, I'm gonna have to figure that out personally, but I will say this, that since I'm chair as well as faculty, I get literally hundreds of emails a day.
Tons, yeah.
And so it's gonna, for me to keep everything organized so that I know that you've done your projects, we will have some sort of Blackboard, Dropbox, database, as you said, situation.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
The invention of photography was not one discovery that led to what we understand as photography today.
There are winners and losers in the evolution of photography.
It's so fascinating at every different point in its history. The way that we familiarize ourselves with the world around us just fundamentally changed with photography.
Silhouette really is the essence. That's the essence of a person's soul. And people knew that. The term photography in Greek is light drawing. So when you're drawing with light, you can do it with chemicals. But before photography, you would look at the shadow, you would trace the shadow. The problem with drawing a shadow of someone is that if you put a person in a room and you put a candle on one side of that person and it casts a shadow, it's a very big shadow. So the biggest problem is, how do you take a very big shadow and make it into a little tiny shadow? So there are tools that they used, the pantograph, these pantograph machine that has these intersecting bars with a pencil, and you could trace the large object and it would make it into a very small object. There was an inventor by the name of Chrétien who invented a device that would trace the shadow of a person through a series of levers. It would then reduce the picture at the same time. And this instrument is called a physionotrace.
The thing about the silhouette and the physionotrace that made them different from a painted portrait was that they were mechanical. They were much more objective portraits of individuals, unlike paintings, which were very subjective.
Camera obscura means dark room. That's all it is. It's a room with no light in it. And if you have a room with no light and you poke a little hole in the side of that room and you let light in from the outside, by miracle, you'll have an image projected upside down, turned around, but in color and moving on the other side of the wall.
It's a phenomenon that people have been aware of for thousands and thousands of years. It's easy to do. It's very often the first project that is taught in photography classes, just as a way to get people to understand the simplicity of what the camera is.
Later improvements of the camera obscura
included putting a lens in the hole so that the light could be focused, so that you would have a brighter and more focused image that would be projected on the wall.
But for photography, the camera is essentially a box. The early experimenters with photography all knew that they wanted to make images in that box.
The story of the invention of photography builds on experiments after experiment.
Johann Heinrich Schultze is a German professor. And in the case of Schultze's experiment, what you have is a glass jar and it's filled with chalk. There's some nitric acid and there's some silver. It's sparingly sensitive to light. So you have this jar with a barrier around the outside. And when light goes through the stencil, it then darkens the chalk that is facing the glass on the inside of the jar. This is where Schultze contributes to the evolution of photography, is that he's proving that this is done by light and not by heat. Thomas Wedgwood was the son of the famous potter Josiah Wedgwood. The signature of the Wedgwood line was the decoration that was made of silhouettes. It's no surprise that one of the Wedgwoods would think that the light which makes a silhouette could also make an image by the action of light. Wedgwood is experimenting with silver nitrate, and he's brushing silver nitrate onto sheets of paper and onto pieces of stretched white leather. He was making images by doing contact prints or photograms. He was putting an object on top of the sensitive paper or leather. And when you put these in the sun, it's very easy to see the effect of light. You can see the paper darkening. So it makes sense that he would want to make pictures in a camera obscura. After all, camera obscuras have been used for years to make an image on a ground glass so that you could do drawings. So you could see the effect of light coming into a camera obscura and producing an image. And yet he had no real success with his process.
He wasn't able to make those images last. He wasn't able to fix the image. Those images were fleeting. They disappeared after a certain amount of time.
Talbot, Daguerre, Niepce, all knew about the work of Wedgwood because Humphrey Davy, his friend, had written an account of his work that was published in 1802. It was a springboard from which other people could then do their own experiments.
So, I seem to have lost my lecture, so let me just find it here. bring it back to the foreground. Okay, so there we go, and let's go back to here and share. It is essentially an empty screen. There it is. Okay, so so that was a really good overview. I think that we're gonna hear from Mark Osterman a few times during the beginnings, especially. He's a kind of he's one of the best researchers on these early photographic processes. And so his collaboration with the George Eastman House in Rochester, through that collaboration, they've made about a dozen videos about that length, about different early processes in photography. I'm gonna show another video for a few minutes, about 5 minutes, and then we're gonna take a short break and we'll come back and I'll be talking more. So I'm going to change the cursor. Hello, cursor. So all right. So as Mark pointed out, camera obscura. Now this is an image, the first published image of the camera obscura, and how if you take a room and you darken it entirely and you poke a small hole in the part of it, as Mark showed in his video, an image will be projected upside down and backwards on the opposite wall. Now, I used to do this in classrooms, and it never ceases to amaze people how incredibly weird it is. And so it is something that, as was pointed out in the video, that's been known for thousands of years. It's theorized that Plato's cave, the classic allegory about life, that Plato and his students were sitting inside a cave that was a natural camera obscura. And what they were seeing, he mentions flickers on the wall a few times in his writings. It's possible, if not even likely, that what they were seeing was a natural camera obscura and making comments and observations about what was going on outside the cave that was then projected on the inside of the cave. So artists have used these for years. This is, it was known all over the world. This is, in Al-Hazan's camera obscura. And so this is not a kind of, unknown physical, the physics of it are really simple, I should say, and kind of well-known. So artists began to use these to make drawings and paintings. One of my favorite artists in the world ever is Jan Vermeer. And it's, fairly conclusive that Vermeer did use some sort of optical device to create his paintings, or perhaps her paintings. One of the things that was I'm talking like the 17th and 18th centuries now. So we're talking about the 1800s and the 1900s. And so when I say things like educated people, that means like less than 1% of the population. And a very, very few people went to school or in college was really just for the elite, rich, what we call the 1% now. And so that needs to be understood. There was no such thing as public education. The vast majority of people would never have learned how to read or write. And so they would have probably never seen art of any kind. Paintings were always kept in the castles of the kings. And so regular folks didn't get to see any kind of visual art, except perhaps the kind they might make themselves. And so what I'm referring to in this case are a very rarefied group of people. But that being said, part of being an educated person in Europe at that time was a thing called the Grand Tour. Now, this is an example of a camera obscura projection. The Grand Tour was essentially a kind of finishing, like after you went to college, I think now we call it a gap year. Instead of going directly into employment, the 1% would travel this ultimately well-established path through Central and Southern Europe, Italy, and other places. And they would go see the kind of great arts and architecture and grand cities of the world. Now, it's likely that they would never leave their home again. They would never travel that way ever again. And so this image, by the way, is of a version of a camera obscura that has a lens and a mirror, and it focuses the image onto a table in the center of a room. There's actually one of these in an apartment on the Upper West Side that people have parties in, and it's kind of interesting. So the idea of the camera obscura began getting smaller, right? Here we've got a desktop camera obscura. It's got a sort of tent over it. And it's no longer a huge room that you have to enter into, but instead you can begin to sort of make drawings, make sketches from life, like on a tabletop. And so they got smaller and smaller. This is a great example. We saw this slide in the video of how they then integrated a lens to make the image brighter and sharper. They integrated a mirror, which flipped the image back over, so it was no longer upside down and backwards. And then you would put a piece of tracing paper on what is essentially a ground glass that we use in a view camera, and just trace the image that was projected into the lens. And you would be able to accurately represent the world, even if you didn't have any drawing skills, right? So the idea is that And again, I will have to say that part of being an educated person at that time included being able to draw. That was a basic concept of educated person. So you'd read and you'd write and you'd arithmetic, but you'd also be able to draw pretty well. The idea of the camera obscura getting smaller means it's more portable. You can take it into wherever you want to go. These are some other examples of camera obscuras that are, this one, the smaller one, you can see that it slides, and that essentially acts like a zoom lens in a way, so that you can bring things that are far away closer to the sketching space on it. There's another view of a camera obscura. The lenses, by the way, were very simple, it's basically a magnifying glass, the kind you get at the drugstore for $5. So you can, make fires or burn ants or whatever. It's really not a very sophisticated lens in any way, but it was such an improvement over just a hole in the box that it made the images visible in light, in daylight, so you could actually draw this and not have to be inside of a darkened room. But to just talk about that for a second, darkened room is the box, right? The camera obscura went from being that room-sized object, right, to a box. It's still a darkened room, a camera. Well, I should say obscura. It's no longer a camera, which in Italian means room. The room is now shrunk down to the size of the box. And in modern day cameras, including your phones, but certainly like more professional cameras, DSLRs and other types of cameras, the box has just been shrunken down to a very small size. AJ?
It just amazes me that back then it took so many years for them just to advance from a room to a small portable box just to have these pictures in. Meanwhile, now we get advancements every few months to a year.
Well, I like your comment a lot, and thank you. I compare this time period and the developments at the beginning of the history of photography to, like, since Steve Jobs kind of invented Apple computer and all of these digital accelerated inventions have happened in the past, let's say 25 to 30 years. It's a very close sort of similar idea. Photography, while it may have taken a while for all of the bits to come together, once it did, it really, a lot of things happened really fast. And then the same thing with the first computers you built out of circuits and that you bought at Radio Shack, and they would like light up four lights or two lights or three, and all of a sudden that become the way I'm talking to you now from my own studio to your homes. It's the same kind of accelerated invention that was happening in analog photography at the beginning that's happening now in the digital world. They got more sophisticated, they got lenses on them that were better, they got the ability to sort of zoom in on things like a zoom lens with a traditional camera does today. This is one that's in the south of England on a on the water, and because the top of here has the mirror in it, you can turn it, and so you can look in any direction 360 degrees, and that will be projected onto the table inside of this one. This is a photographer named Abelardo Morel, and he uses the concept of the camera obscura in his work today. Now, what he does is he goes to people's apartments, in this case, in New York City. That's, I think that's the Con Ed building there by the piano and the plug. And essentially uses a lot of black paper and darkens the whole apartment. And then while he's inside it, just like in the traditional old school camera obscura, he sits down or sets up its tripod and then photographs the camera obscura projections on the walls inside the apartment, but with all the owner's stuff, right? Their chair, their piano, whatever, the clock on the wall. we sort of went from this huge thing, a full-size room, to my lens is longer than your lens, camera obscuras, to the Kodak Brownie. Now, the original Kodak Brownie was just a simple box. It had a meniscus lens in it, which again is just a single element magnifying lens in the first Kodak. I just call it a Kodak, but I call it a Kodak camera. And we'll talk more about the Kodak girl, as they were known, Kodak women, as they should have been known, in another lecture. But it's really interesting to see how we went from that to that to that, right? And so here's a contemporary artist made camera obscura. And what you can do in this case is you can stick your DSLR camera into the box and then photograph what's inside the box. So, that's a cheap meniscus lens, just some foam core and some black gaffer's tape. But instead of drawing it, which you can do, you can also photograph it with a camera. So here's some more examples of Abe Morel, then we'll take a break. As I said, he sets up, he goes into people's houses all over the world, blackens out all the windows, and then pokes a hole in the windows and photographs what's projected on the other side. And I love that he sort of leaves the detritus of whoever lives there in the image. So it's a kind of mix of the external world with the internal world that we live in all the time. All right, I'm gonna take a break now. And so let's see, it's now 12:20, let's say. So we're gonna start again at 12:35. That gives you 15 minutes. And I'm gonna eat something. So I'm gonna sort of turn my camera off and my sound off. And I will see you back in 15 minutes, which is 12:35, okay? So we're back. Another device that sort of was, that contributed to sort of the invention of photography was this device called camera lucida. Now it's not technically a camera in the sense that there is no room like in the camera obscura, right? So this is a device, I actually have one that I bought. This is called the Neo Lucida, and it was put together by some art professors to help students draw in drawing classes. But the idea of a camera lucida is that there's a little prism at the end up here, and that you mount it onto a table. So you can see there that the prism. These filters are to help people see in black and white, actually. And then you mount it on a long stick like this, and it's got a clamp on the other end so that it will easily clamp to the table. There's been like children's versions of these over the years, but here it is sort of in action, if you will. So you clamp it to your drawing table, right? So take a tripod out to mount your drawing pad or drawing table on. And this is the tricky part, and it takes a lot of getting used to, but you have to look actually straight down. And what you see is that the prism both sees the real world out front, and it looks like it's projected onto the paper. It's not actually projected. It's just that illusion of the way the prism sort of lets you see both things at once. And once you see both things at once, you can essentially trace the image that is, it's not projected. So it's just sort of like visible through the prism onto it. I had hoped this would work better, frankly, than it did. They came out with a newer Neo Lucida that has a much bigger mirror and much bigger prism. And I can certainly see why that's the case, because this one is very difficult to get exactly into the right place. but it allows people to draw from life without sort of having perspective, training in sort of realistic rendering, so to speak. I mean, obviously you still have to understand things like shading and tone and value. And you can, I guess you could just do a sort of simple outline trace, but it helps if you can sort of add shading and tone as well. Excuse me. the great advantage of this, of course, is it's much more portable than bringing along a camera obscura, which were significantly large boxes. And so here's another sort of example of how it works, right? There's the prism in the eyepiece. You look straight down and your hand sees an image on the paper, or your eyes see an image on your paper that your hand can trace. And it's essentially the image that's straight out in front that is being kind of prism reflected through the eyepiece.
So I have a question. Like you said, it's not being reflected, but it's just the fact that you're able to see two things at the same time.
That's right. Exactly right. In some of the illustrations, it looks like it's reflected onto the paper. That's not actually true. So it is just that you see it. It sort of looks like it's there. So excuse me just a moment. Okay, hopefully that will stop. So that's the one that I bought. As I said, they have a newer version that's significantly better. there was a book that David Hockney put out, I don't know, it's probably been 20, 25 years ago now, that was very controversial when it came out. And it was called Secret Knowledge, Rediscovering the Lost Techniques of the Old Masters. Hockney himself is a rather well-known British, now living in California, pop artist and painter primarily, although he does photography as well. And he did some research and found out that a lot of the old master painters more than likely used some of these optical devices. And so, that's Hockney himself working with a camera Lucida, right? And he did a kind of BBC show about this as well, where he demonstrates how a camera obscura works. And he actually does a painting on the show using a portable, like a camera obscura he made with just some black drapes. sorry about my throat. And so he's got this, sort of set up in the room in front of him. And then he has that then projected onto the wall upside down and backwards into the opposite wall, where he has a canvas set up and he paints from the image that, in this case, since it is an obscura, it's projected on the wall. So this is another really interesting sort of short documentary, about a little less than an hour. It was produced by Penn of Penn and Teller, if you know who they are. And it's about this guy who's actually a computer graphics guy. He's not a painter, who...
There is a tsunami of defaults coming our way. there is a tsunami of evictions coming our way.
Sorry about the ads.
In fact, there are over 40 million Americans.
Skip it.
Sometimes when I'm trying to get to sleep, all I can think about is trying to paint a Vermeer, who some consider the greatest painter of all time. At the face of it, that seems almost impossible, because I'm not a painter. I'm a computer graphics guy, and we use technology to make a realistic, beautiful image.
Tim and I have been friends for a really long time. I didn't know he had this whole little sub-obsession with Vermeer.
I'm looking at this image, and I see something that looks like it came out of a video camera. This fall-off of light is something that an artist really cannot see. There must be a way to actually get the colors accurate with mechanical means. I propped up a small mirror at a 45-degree angle. Right on the forehead, you can see that they match.
Holy cow.
Took me about half an hour to learn how to operate a paintbrush.
Good for you, it took me 40 years.
It's possible that he was more of a tinkerer, more of a geek. And in that way, I feel a kinship with him.
So I'm going to construct a replica of the exact room where Vermeer painted.
That's right. The harpsichord, the Spanish chair, the viola da gamba, the rug. The wind's trying to blow my shape. Well, this certainly is not easy.
This is very ingenious.
That's where the painting is, Buckingham Palace.
Using Tim's device, you become a machine.
I'm proposing an alternate history of Vermeer.
Was Vermeer a machine?
Oh, my God.
I think it might disturb quite a lot of people.
We weren't making a film when I quit. Yeah, I definitely would. I would find something else to do right now.
Did you see the video?
The old masters had secretive image projecting device.
Yes.
Okay. Let's get back to here. And actually, I need to go back to here. Share. Screen, just that, and so he did it, by the way. It's really an interesting documentary that if you're interested in this kind of stuff, it's definitely worth an hour of your time. So Jan Vermeer, who there's only about 18 paintings or so of his or hers, because it's a mystery who they were, they still exist. My wife and I have a quest to see them all, which is impossible because one of them is actually in Buckingham Palace, and he actually convinced the Queen, Tim did, to let him in to see it for half an hour without a camera and without any drawing devices. But so if we look, really analyze Vermeer's paintings, there are things in them that you really can't see with the human eye. And one of those things is specular highlights. Now, these are the kinds of things that you see in photographs where the highlights become so washed out that they just become solid white. So there's certain details in the painting. This is something known as a circle of confusion, which is also an optical sort of thing. It doesn't happen in your own eyes, but instead is only formed by a lens. So other artists that it's sort of, you know, thought they might have used optical devices like the Arnolfini Wedding here. And so this kind of uber detail, inside a reflection of detail. Again, we see specular highlights and circles of confusion in the details of this painting. There's another thing that was happening in the 19th century. My wife really loves this. So when you went to visit somebody, when you went to see a friend, let's say, before there were cars, those visits would sometimes be at least 4 days long, probably more like up to 2 weeks at a time. And so if you had a friend that lived in another village 100 miles away, you couldn't just drive there in an hour and a half or 2 hours. It would take you like a day and a half to get there or more. And a day and a half to get back. So why just go for one afternoon? That seems silly. And so they would stay for a long time. And especially the, I think the reason my wife likes this so much is because, you know, she's obsessed with the kind of limitations that were put on young Victorian women. And so what would happen a lot of times is they'd get together, groups of two or three families, spend long periods of time together. Remember, there's no TV, there's no movies, there's no video games, there's no internet, there's no, you know, whatever. And so they would do these things, which are kind of like miniature plays, but without words, and they were called tableau vivant. Now, what they were, oftentimes, would they would sort of raid the costume box and pick a passage from a play or some other thing like Shakespeare, a poem maybe, and they would recreate it visually just for the fun of it, just to kind of make this tableau, so to speak, right? And so they would maybe pick a historical event that happened and just to have fun, they would dress up into the appropriate costumes and it's less than a play in the sense that they don't actually have multiple scenes and there's not dialogue or anything, but they would all just sort of get together and do this thing. And it was really popular. I mean, people of all kinds of, you know, levels of society really did this. And, you know, it's clearly a sort of beginning of cinematography in a way. There's a kind of relationship to a lot of contemporary photographers who now stage their photographs, you know, especially contemporary art photographers who create pictures rather than take pictures, right? They make rather than take. And there were, it was particularly popular with the women, the young women and women of all ages, because it gave them something to fucking do, frankly. I mean, usually women at that era weren't allowed outside. They weren't allowed to read. That, you know, there were so many, they dress up in like five layers of clothing and have everything cinched so tight they could barely breathe. It was hell to be a woman in the 19th century in Victorian England. And so just to have anything to distract them from their everyday boring lives, they would sort of do these tableau vivant. And some were more campy than others. And I think camp in a way is kind of part of it, which is a very contemporary term from the 1970s that Susan Sontag sort of talked a lot about. But there is a kind of like very dramatic over the top quality to these tableau vivant. There's actually a link in the Gutenberg Library that has examples of them, which I think is really fantastic. Oh shit, I need to finish. Anyways, so here's some home pastimes or tableau vivant. and there's a link in the lecture. Now, I have to talk to you all for a minute here. I have to finish early on my lectures because my wife has to teach at 2 from this workstation. So I won't be able to go right up till 2 o'clock as we're supposed to do. My apologies for that. It's just what we're dealing with in our lives right now. So I'm gonna finish for now. I can probably take 1 or 2 questions, but just to review very quickly, your assignment is the Whitney Museum exhibition, the collective of African-American photographers that were there at that show. Either go in person or instead use the website and that wonderful video that Cole shared for us, thank you very much, and have a look at that. Make something or write something about that. That's your main assignment. On the website, there are also, I think, a half dozen or so links that I'm asking you to sort of view. And let me get the website back up. Here it is. I'll go to here and share that screen with you. And so you'll see in the first week here, you know, there's that many. Now we saw the Tim's Vermeer thing already. And so they're all kind of like that. I'd like you to look at the Baudelaire on photography and then have a look at some of these videos and websites. So that's your assignment for this week. I can take probably one question. Does anybody have a question?
I have one. How are we submitting this to you? Through Blackboard? Yeah. I know you don't like Blackboard, but how are we submitting these things?
I haven't determined that yet. So it may be Blackboard, it may be Dropbox or something like that. But just for next week, just have it handy. We're gonna talk about it at the beginning of class for a few minutes and then keep it so that when I do figure that out, you can drop it in there, okay? Okay. All right, thank you all. Have a good week. I'm really excited.
Thank you.
Thank you. Enjoy it as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
Thanks.